Well, hello. My name is Mikhail Pimenov. You can call me Misha. I prefer to be called Misha. If we can agree that you put your phones away so that you're not distracted with Facebook, Instagram, whatnot, yeah? Or TikTok, if somebody wants to record the dance. I was told that today's topic is how did I become a serial entrepreneur. And my immediate reaction was by coincidence. I didn't plan, I was not born to become an entrepreneur. I didn't plan to open my company. I actually didn't know what to do when I was your age. I was also a graduate of an independent international university. Maybe you have heard of International Christian University. It was also founded in Kiev back in the days. Unfortunately, it doesn't exist right now. Who knows? Maybe in the future. But I am an alum of International Christian University, which is very similar to your university, where all the studying is in English. Some of you are from... How many of you are from Flex program? Any of you from Flex? No? Okay. I'm also an alum of Flex. Maybe you have heard of it. Future Exchange Leader program, or previously it was called Freedom Support Act. It's a program for high school kids to go and study for 1 year in the US. So that was my start of the journey. Guys, if this is very important, the corridor is all yours, okay? I'm here for 1 hour, I'm speaking. You can always ask me a question. Please interrupt, ask a question. Then you'll continue your important conversations. Agree? Excellent. So, like I said, I started my journey back in those days. That was 1994, 95. I was born in Soviet Union, so I was a schoolboy, a Soviet schoolboy. Then in 91, Ukraine got its independence, and out of a sudden, you know, I became Ukrainian. Just because my family was here, I was born in Kiev, so we became independent Ukrainians. Then I had my year in the US, and then I continued in the International Christian University. So coming back, how did I become who I am now, yeah? I remember myself on the third year of the university. Everybody wanted to be a banker, or being involved in the financial sector. But at the same time, everybody was running around just looking for a job. You meet, you know, your friend is like, "Do you have a job?" "No, I don't. I'm looking." "Oh, do you have a job?" "Yeah, I have a job." So I met one girl from my university in the end. I said, "Olya, do you work anywhere?" And she said, "Yeah, I'm working at an advertising agency." I said, "Wow, that's interesting." And the second question, which came immediately after the first question, is like, "Do you have a job opening? Do you have a job to do?" And she said, "You know what? Actually, I am looking for an assistant. Why don't you come in a few days for an interview?" I had no clue what advertising was about. A month ago, I remember, before that conversation happened, I remember there was another advertising agency recruiting people, and when they called me up and asked, like, "Okay, can you describe me what promotion is?" And I said, "Well, promotion is when a person is promoted from one position to another." And they said, "Thank you, bye-bye." Promotion is totally different in advertising. So that was my first experience. But second experience, when I came to the interview, and that was for the position of account executive. So basically, the lower rank of a manager in the client service department of the advertising agency. And there was just one question from the creative director and from the director: "Which advertising do you like?" And you probably don't remember, but there was a mobile operator, Golden Telecom. And I said, "You know what, I really love Golden Telecom." And of course, by coincidence, that was the advertising campaign done by this creative director. So he was very, very flattered because of that. So I got a job. So that was a very short interview, and that was my first job. And since then, since 1998, I'm stuck, or I've been stuck in advertising ever since. So I started as a fax machine, you know, doing simple stuff, copying, delivering, calling, etc. And then I was just, you know, building my career year on year in the advertising industry in the client service department. So basically communicating with clients. So there is a creative people, there are creative people who come up with ideas, who do design, who do voiceover, copywriting, this and that, and you are the guy, you are the middleman between the client and your team to deliver the best product. Then, what happened next? So in between, I quit advertising for a while, and I became the director of the rock band, Okeanelze. So back in 2005, I was involved in show business. I was working with Okeanelze. If you remember, there was, what's the name of the album? Gloria. The name of the album was Gloria, which was released. Я не здамся без бою, these were the hits. So that was right after the Orange Revolution, you know, the whole society, the whole population was pumped up, hyped because of that. The rest is history, I'm not gonna comment on that. But then afterwards I came back to advertising. Show business is great, behind the scenes experience is awesome, but you know, I'm not a musician, I hardly can distinguish one thing from another. So for me, you know, the music industry was not mine. Yeah. So I came back to advertising agency. I became general manager of the network agency, Young and Rubicon. And afterwards, in 3 years, right after the crisis hit, 2008, in a year and a half, I basically. That was the moment, the coincidence, that I decided to change my hats from a corporate hat, working for somebody, by opening my own company and becoming an entrepreneur. And that was a totally different experience. First of all, because as an entrepreneur, you cannot rely on institutions or on a team or on your top management or your subordinates or your, you know, other offices around the world. You can only rely on yourself, especially at the very beginning. So you occupy the position from the courier to the, you know, whoever you want to call yourself, you know, a director, owner, a god, whatever. But the spectrum, I can tell you, because it's, at the end of the day, the most important thing is for you to deliver. Whether it's a document to your client, because you know you have to deliver. Nobody else will care as much as you will, yeah? But then, of course, you build the company. We are in the 10th year. We do advertising production. We do it as an outsource. We work with international clients. We export our services, just like IT guys do. So, you know, in 10 years, you look back and you think, you know what, it's not that bad. You know, to be an entrepreneur is great. You know, you belong to yourself as well as you belong to your business. As well as you belong to your, you know, client needs, as well as you belong to your employees' needs or team needs. But I can tell you, you know, I would do, if I'm being asked 10 years ago again, I would have made the same choice. Back then, not knowing, I was stepping into unknown waters. I didn't know what will happen, especially after the crisis. On my corporate position, I would probably default in terms of my liabilities and in terms of my revenues or salary. So I had to do something. So the trigger is not always something that you are really planning, something that you are sober about it, something that you think, okay, this is the way I will do it. No, entrepreneurship is a roller coaster. You can plan and you should plan, but it's always a matter of your immediate judgment, you know, your decision making, whether it's then you find out whether that was a failure or a success, whether you know you did everything and then out of the sudden client or potential client says, you know what, you know, we chose a different option. And you say, and I spent so much time, I spent so much effort, so much money to prepare, and I was almost there, but almost. Next day you wake up and you do it all over again. Also what entrepreneurship brings to my mind as part of my experience is that you become more open to new ideas. When you're in the corporate seat, your main responsibility is to drive business of this particular company. Whether it's, I mean, in any industry, let me not, you know, describe industries, but in any industry. That's your primary focus. And you, and that's nothing wrong with it, as a corporate suit, you can grow your career, you can start earning a lot of money, you can get all your bonuses, this and that, yeah? As an entrepreneur, from what I experience myself, you become open to new ideas, to new projects. You start opening other businesses. After several years of having an advertising production company, I bought a franchise and I launched a new business here. It's called Chargello. And by the way, the name of the company of the production of advertising production is called Pepelots Production. For those of you who are interested in Soviet science fiction movies, Pepelots stands for a spaceship. For a spaceship from movie Kinzadza. Does it ring a bell to anybody? No. Fine. I recommend you, when you get interested in Soviet science fiction movies, you watch Kinzadza. Otherwise, continue watching Netflix. So I launched a franchise. It's called Chargello. It's the B2B business for restaurants. Charging batteries for your phones. So clients come in to the restaurant. There is always a situation when you need to charge the phone. They bring you the battery. They charge the phone. There is advertising on the battery. That's how I earn money. I am organizing a basketball camp for kids right now. I'm bringing American coaches for this camp. The first camp will be in on the premises of the Kyiv International School this December. I'm telling you what I've told you for the opening up for new ideas, for new thoughts. These are the, you can call it side projects or new projects or new initiatives that you as an entrepreneur can bet on them. You basically risk personally with your own money, or if it's a partnership with your money and your partner's money, and you do some business. You can be very successful in it. You can return your investment and say, I earned a little bit of money. Or you can fail and you move on. But you have your own, your primary business that is a cash cow for all of these nice new ideas. So again, becoming a serial entrepreneur is not a panacea. You know, it's not something that you have to strive for. You can become an entrepreneur, grow a company, sell a company. When you sell it, you can get a role in this company and kind of come back, you know, finish the cycle. You've been in the corporate suit, like I told you. You've been building your career. Then you started your company. Then you grew the company, then you sell it to like institutional investor, institutional player. So let's say another production company comes from the US and says, Misha, we are interested in buying, in acquiring your company, and we would like you to run it further on. But of course, you will run it again as a corporate man, part of our bigger organization. If you want it, if it's a challenge for you, new experience, you know, something that you haven't dealt with, more international exposure, this and that, yeah, you say, yeah, that would be interesting. Or you say, no, 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 I'm not interested. I want to exit. I want to cash out. I want to do something else. I want to, you know, open up a hotel on the Portuguese seaside and try that. Or I want to invest in IT. I want to do a rock band myself. I don't know. I mean, it's up for, to your judgment. Or I want to do some social thing. Have you heard of this corporate social responsibility? Of course you have heard of it, yeah? What is this?
A steering means agreement, so.
Sorry?
Steering means agreement, so we agree with you.
Ah, steering means agreement.
No.
I don't get it. What is corporate social responsibility?
It's important for company to reassure the employees that afterwards, after their retirement, for example, they're going to have like pensions, and they're going to have like social support. I mean, within the city, you know, like their children are able to go to the kindergarten, their children are able to get educated, and different like social things that company could be like partially responsible for the employees.
That's a very good example. So basically, when there are activities in the company that are not linked only to the, you know, earning revenues, not only to business matters, but to social matters. Just like you said, maybe they open up a kindergarten where kids of their employees go. Or maybe they...
some medical insurance.
Healthcare.
Yeah. Or maybe they say, okay, we want to plant thousands of trees around our factory, let's say, just to help the nature. Or we want to encourage our employees to take all the plastic and put it in the box in that corner. Or to change all the light bulbs into the energy saving bulbs, etc., etc. So there are numerous things. During the Revolution of Dignity, back in, 2014, there was, and I'm sure you felt it yourself, the volunteer movement was very big, yeah? Everybody was helping everybody, yeah? Out of this volunteer movement came a lot of, you know, initiatives and projects that support, in many ways, different groups of people, different cases, etc., etc. And as an entrepreneur, I still remain to be just a human being, a person. And as a person, you can also involve yourself in some social cause. Something that doesn't bring you immediate effect in terms of, you know, earning money or, you know, PR effect of becoming more famous or public figure, etc. Sometimes you just give without, you know, thinking of receiving, without expecting to receive something. What you receive is something which is inside you. Yeah, you receive appreciation for yourself, by yourself. So I'm going to show you a project that I was involved since 2016. That as you can see the date, it's 2017. And the project is called Invictus Games. Who have heard of Invictus Games? What is Invictus Games?
This is games for people who, I can't say it in English, but I understand.
Disabilities, she wanted to say.
Who are invalids.
Disabled, yeah. But not only that, they're from, these people are,
deprived.
What
are these people from the wars?
Exactly. So these are the games for the veterans. These are the international games for the veterans, the across all the countries, all the country participants, who have been in the war zone and who have been wounded. So they're not specifically, I mean, the criteria is wider. Some of them are disabled. Some of them don't have limbs, like arms or legs. But some of them can be just wounded, but they still participate in these games. And this initiative was done by Prince Harry from the United Kingdom. And it involves 17 nations across the world who have, unfortunately, who have veterans. And I'm saying unfortunately because we would all wish that we don't have wounded soldiers and we don't have any casualties and we don't have any suffering in the families. But these games really help, first of all, psychologically, because there is a psychological trauma to every veteran who comes back. They're not coming back clean, and they will never be clean in this respect. They will always be traumatized. And our task as a society to reduce this trauma, to help them adapt back to the society, to help them realize themselves. Because they feel abandoned. They feel as if the society doesn't need them. And as you can imagine, especially when you're disabled, our Ukrainian world is not perfect for it. How many buildings, the entrances of the building have the right pandus, I don't know what's in English, you know, for the wheelchair, for the wheelchair. Do you guys have it here? And then count the number of buildings, etc., etc. And sport has been proven as a great rehabilitation rehabilitation technique to bring them back, to find the new purpose in life. Because it's also competition, and as you can imagine, on the battlefield, it's pure competition. It's either you or your enemy. So sports competition is a substitution for it, yeah? And they feel that they have this purpose. So let me show you, how can we switch off the light? Can we switch off the light? Great, thank you. Even better. Oh, yeah, yeah. So when you're thinking of doing something, when you're thinking of your own initiative, whether it's business initiative or, you know, social cause, just like I told you about Invictus or any other things, or planting a tree, or saving a cat, or a dog, a stray dog, yeah? Don't buy a breed dog. Take one from the shelter. It's the same dog. She or he will give you the same love. Why not help him or her? Do you know who is he? Do you know this guy? This is the character from Russian literature. And he has his last name. It starts with O.
No.
Okay, you should remember, this guy, his name is Oblomov. Oblomov. And we have this definition of Oblomovshina. Oblomovshina is when you have tons of great ideas, but you're lying on the sofa, and you're saying, oh, wouldn't it be great, you know, to save all the penguins in the Arctic, or all the white bears. Oh, I would really join Greenpeace. Such a nice idea. And then nothing happens. And of course, you know, we are also governed, or we are also sometimes in the hands of the laziness. Even myself. Or maybe even I am more lazy than you guys are. And that's fine. That's the nature of the human being. Sometimes we are lazy. Sometimes we procrastinate. You know this word, procrastinate, and we just don't do anything, we just sit and or lie on the sofa. However, if you have a good idea, and you think you would really want to do something about it, just take a first step, take a second step. After the, you know, after a mile of your walking or running, you will see the first results. And again, they don't have to be perfect. They don't have to be, you know, recognized by anybody. It's you who first has to recognize. So, ideas, don't let them be with Oblomov. Try to get away from the sofa. Okay, a little bit of inspiration. Here you go.
Here's a challenge. How do you capture four amazing days of sport? An opening ceremony, a closing concert, all in 2 minutes. Thousands of stories, hundreds of competitors. Here are my favorite bits. We are Invictus. And do all you can to lift up everyone around you. I'll see you in Toronto.
And that was the first year we as Ukraine have become a nation participant. So it took the public sector, Grozdansky public, yeah? The public sector.
Civil
sector, thank you. Civil sector to actually bring this idea, because the governmental sector was not really interested. Just because it's a lot of work, there's no budget, you know, the possibility or the probability was not high, because you really need to make an effort. So it was a civil sector where I was involved. I found my, you know, allies, and we together came, you know, we prepared the set of documents, we sent it to the foundation of Prince Harry, saying that Ukraine has to become, because unfortunately, as of 2014, we are getting our veterans, and they have to participate as part of this movement, as part of the Invictus Games. Invictus, by the way, in Latin, it means unconquered. In Ukrainian, it's we call it Neskoreni, Igry Neskorene. Invictus Games. So in 2017, that was the first year that Team Ukraine, 15 veterans, because we got a quota of 15 athletes who can go, who could go and participate in Toronto, Canada. That was the first year. The second year, in 2018, that was Sydney, Australia. And now, next year, 2020, in May, the Ukrainian team will participate a third time in the Hague, Netherlands, Gaga, in the Hague. And the brilliance of the game is that every time the team is always new. So every time 15 veterans are getting, new 15 veterans are getting the chance to participate. So for 2017 there was one set of 15 people, for 2018 another set of 15 people, and for the Hague we're getting 20 people now, so our quota was increased. So 20 people are going there. And we have seen the results for these boys, mainly boys. There was one girl in the first team, there was another girl in the second team, and I'm sure there are two ladies in our third team. Obviously, the participation of women in the combat is much lower than actually in other countries. Like in the US team, in the Canadian team, in Great Britain, in the UK team, there are much more women involved. And there were much more women with wounds, which was interesting. So, like I said, the civil society was the driver. But of course, it's a multi-stakeholder approach. We wouldn't be able to do it just as, you know, citizens of Ukraine. You had to involve the state. It was the Ministry of Defense at the end of the day who was the primary contact, because that was the Ministry of Defense from the Great Britain who were officially inviting us. So they couldn't say, "Hello, Misha, we officially invite, you know, Ukraine to the Invictus Games." It was from the Ministry of Defense to the Minister of Defense. Then we also got support from media. STB channel was our informational
partner.
Yeah, was our. They've invested their own money. They've made a special program. They had a group of journalists traveling with us to Toronto, Sydney, and they will travel. Well, this year it will be probably a different media partner, but nevertheless, I mean, they've really helped us. Then local and international non-governmental organizations, they've helped us a lot. NATO organization, their branch in Kyiv, have financed transportation for us, because you should understand, we didn't have a penny, we didn't have a budget, because the budget is approved like half a year before the end of the year for the next year, and we only got to know about the Invictus in October, so there was nothing in the Ministry of Defense to support it, so we had to run around and find sponsors, find money in, from the international organizations, this and that. I think it's doubled. Something else has to be written here, and I don't remember which one, but okay, state is there, media is there, NGOs, civil society.
Maybe business.
Private sector, maybe.
Private sector, I guess, business, yes, sponsors. There were a number of sponsors who helped us. So without all these elements, that as well wouldn't be possible. So again, from the idea, get rid of Oblomov, get inspired, you know, try to make it happen, but then remember, sometimes you cannot own it to the full. You cannot own it to the 100%, because you will fail. You have to involve many people or many stakeholders. It's not only people, it's organizations. And then it will happen, and then you will be successful. Because usually, especially in business, you think, oh, if I, you know, involve too many people and we earn this money and then I have to distribute all the money, what I'll get? I'll get nothing, or I'll get peanuts. I don't want it. I want everything to myself, because I wanna be famous, I wanna be rich, I wanna fly super jets, you know, but especially for the social cause, it doesn't work like that. Or if you have all the money in the world and you want to just spend it, of course, but still, you have to build the team. You have to have, you know, everybody to execute. But in this particular case, it's the multi-stakeholder approach when you gather all the right people. So I told you about the Team Ukraine, that was great. It's all about the team at the end. We had this nice flag when we were presenting the team, and everybody, you know, put their signature and some wishes for us before we went to Toronto. So that was really, really cool. Where's mine? And of course, like I said, you don't do it, you have to also remember, you don't do it for yourself. Not that you alienate yourself in that, not that you don't need appreciation for what you do, but you have to know why you do it. And you do it for them. Like I told you, they are the focus of the project. Yeah? Here is Pepelats, as part of the whole crowd. As you can see, these are all the governmental institutions, the organizing committee, initiators of the project, partners. But they are key. Without them, we don't need to do it. Without them, we don't need the Invictus Games. But these guys and Katya, they needed it the most, you know. We were, and Estebel, like I told you, they participated, and they, by the way, brought very good result. There is no ranking in the Invictus Games. Like in the Olympics, there is always ranking. Which country got the most gold medals, silver medals, bronze medals, and then there is ranking who's number one, who's number two, etc. Since it's a social, since it has a social purpose to it, there is no competition between countries. Everybody is a winner already. However, if thinking of the results, there is also a big difference in the number of athletes per country. So like the US team has got almost like 100 veterans. Canada had like 70. UK had also like 70. And then, you know, you go down and we had only 15. But our 15 athletes got, I think, 13 gold medals, then some silver medals and bronze medals. So when you count it back, or when you, you know, summarize it in the ranking for yourself, we were number two because we had a lot of gold medals. And gold medals are the most precious in terms of points. But even, you know, without the sports results, all of these guys, you know, some of them continue. I think Panchenko, he's in the Paralympic team right now for archery. He continued to do the archery. Pasha, he's working in the veteran hub. So everybody is doing something, has found a new direction in life or a social lift. Sometimes we call it that. So, and these are the first 15. And of course, the halo effect is much bigger because before you appear in the team, there are national competitions inside of Ukraine. And around 500 veterans take part in this competition. And they are inspired by it. We have a veteran who is going for the, who is going to The Hague. And he competed for the during those 3 years, three times. Three times, and only on the third time he achieved. And he's going as part of the national team for the international competition. So that just tells that there is so much motivation because of this project, specifically for this group of people. Yeah, these are our medals. Ah, that's my favorite one. You know this word.
Yeah.
Like modern.
Yeah. Yeah, like. Reserved. Don't forget, we all strive to get, you know, to the result, to get to a success, to be strong, to be wise, to be clever, to be liked, to be appreciated, etc., etc. And when you get to the pinnacle of your success, don't forget this word. Because when you're on top, and you think, you know, the rest is evolving around you, you're almost on the Olympus, or you are on the Olympus, as you think, as you may think, try to keep this word in your head. Be humble about your achievements. They can be great. You can be somebody sitting here as the next Mrs. Rowling, thinking of the new Harry Potter. And that's great. But you know her story. How many publishers she has visited before one decided, okay, let me try, maybe 1,000 books. And we'll see what not. If it goes, it goes. If it doesn't, maybe I will break even, I will not lose money. But I don't know. I mean, it's thick, lots of words, lots of meanings, too many names, etc., etc. And now, everybody knows what happened afterwards, yeah? But, from what I know, from what I read, from what I see, I think she didn't forget this word. I think she is... what she's doing, what kind of initiatives she has, besides writing books and publishing books and writing screenplays for the movies, etc., etc. She has a lot of programs with a social cause. She does a lot of support. So I think she's got something. Besides, you know, the understanding that she's mega successful, mega rich, mega influential. She appears in the Forbes 100 women, most influential women, etc., etc. When you get to this point, again, I beg of you, don't forget. Because if you don't forget, you'll do even more. You'll be able to bring more results, more new interesting ideas, initiatives, projects, in business and outside of business. Oh. And of course, I'm humble here, you know, very humble, extremely humble. I'm not heavily involved right now with the Invictus. You know, there is a team of people who do that now. I'm telling you as my great experience, as part of my life, you know, which happened during my life 3 years ago. And that was great. And I go on with other projects. I have so many ideas. I want to realize so many projects. That was one of my projects. And I'm happy that it continues. This one doesn't need me anymore. So I'm not dragging onto it. But that was great. I mean, it was great to see Prince Harry. That's the boxer. What's his name? Louis, yeah? Anyway, the biggest pleasure for me was meeting this guy. Do you know him? That's Mike Myers, Shrek. Yeah. And Austin Powers, for those who like old-fashioned movies. So, yeah, such a great experience. So much emotion, so much fun. And we will finish on a fun note. That was the closing ceremony of the Toronto Games. So that's that. If you guys want to ask me any questions, want to comment on anything, let's use this remaining couple of minutes. Thank you. Anything you want to ask? Say.
Do we have time?
Okay.
What was the hardest about organizing Invictus? Maybe fundraising or something.
Sorry,
else?
What?
What was the hardest thing to do when you did Invictus?
I think first of all the bureaucracy, dealing with the government. Once we found the solution to, you know, to build the vertical, we had Ivana Klimpush Tsintsadze, the vice prime minister for the euro integration. And she became the head of the project from the government. Then it was much easier. And the second biggest challenge was finding money, finances. The reason being there was when we were doing it in 2016, 2017, I could feel there is a fatigue. That people were tired and companies were tired because everybody supported during 2014 to 2015 as volunteers, as just donors, giving the money, giving commodities, going somewhere, doing something, organizing something, etc., etc. And then, you know, people go to the back to the normal life. And when you come and ask for more money, or for new money, for a new project, it wasn't easy. So we had to really run around. Mm-hmm.
And why our team didn't take part this year during the Invictus Games?
There was basically they took such a high pace doing games every year. So this year after the Sydney, which happened in October last year. They didn't have enough time to prepare for this year. So the decision was made that this year will be a break, and the next year in May, they will continue in The Hague.
But they just didn't recover after this kind of trip?
No. It's not about our veterans. It's about the logistics and organization from the main foundation. So we just adhered to their rules. So we didn't miss anything. We continue, consecutively. In the third year. Mm-hmm. Can I ask you? I would like to ask you. My question is, how many of you would like to start your own business instead of going and working for the company? 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. Well, almost 50-50. Cool. Very cool. I think you guys have a lot of opportunities. I think the world has changed a lot from the 90s. I'm the teenager of the 90s, which was very different from what it is now. You know, I am a teenager of an analog phone. You know, remember this phone when you had to do... Hello? You were born. You are born already holding the smartphone in your hand. And it's totally different. So many new businesses, were created during the past, 10, 15 years, which we've never heard, and now we all use. And we do not even imagine ourselves without it. So I'm sure you've got tons of opportunities for those who raise hands to come up with your ideas. You have so many accelerators, so many, platforms, fields, where you can come up, present your idea, maybe find allies, unite as a group, and continue working. Get some funding. It's much more easier. Also, boundaries are pretty much open. You can travel, you can see new things. You can continue studying somewhere, not only here. It was quite a challenge back in the days, I can tell you. So I think I can only wish you good luck with all your endeavors, with all your ideas. think, you know, don't forget about Oblomov, okay? Some of the ideas will be eaten by him, but some you will be able to realize. Secondly, inspiration. Yeah, you can be inspired by so many things. Thirdly, find the right partners. Yes, it's you, and yes, it's your success. But, you know, don't be afraid to share your success, and your failure, by the way, and your hardships, and your efforts, and your marathon. It's not going to be sprint all the time. Sometimes it's going to be marathon. I like the pictures of Steve Jobs' garage, and I like the picture of, what's the Amazon name?
Jeff Bezos
sitting in this small cubicle doing his Amazon thing. I love him. You can have your own picture, but they had marathons. They didn't do it overnight. They didn't succeed in a year or two. It's a marathon. It's a fun marathon. So thirdly, what did I say? Find the right partners. And the fourth, and the last one, and the most important for me, is what?
Humble.
Exactly. Be humble. Humble. Don't forget this word. This is very important. Very important. It will help you. I have no more questions to you. I understand half of you, and then another half of you may become entrepreneurs after building your career in the corporate sector. And that's perfectly fine. Some of you will build it in the corporate sector. Some of you will build it in the non-commercial, non-governmental sector. And that's another important role to have. Some of you will become to the state. You'll go to the state and you'll work as a governmental official. And that's another path to your career. You've got a nice highway. So I wish you, you know, to have a good car, good wheels, good gasoline, or maybe not gasoline, good lithium batteries. Yeah, because gasoline will be, these cars will be gone soon. So everything is in your hands. Okay?
Thank you so much.
Have a good day.